didn't realize this would be so fun. Hey, everybody. So this is an amazing story about this song. Much more here than I thought there would be. Apparently the tone on this, and a lot of you guys might know this, but the tone on this kind of happened by mistake. Mountain was getting ready for a gig at the Fillmore West in 1969, and some boxes showed up at the airport, and Leslie expected to find Marshall amps in those boxes, Leslie West. What he found was a Sun PA head and four 412 Sun cabinets. And his heart sank because he thought, oh no, I can't use these. But when he plugged into the Sun PA head, it was the sound that you hear on Mississippi Queen. And he was like overjoyed. So this is what ended up being recorded on Mississippi Queen, this Sun PA head. And a lot of you guys might know this. Now what happened to Sun is even more interesting because apparently a band called the Kingsmen, which had this huge hit called Louie Louie, they were on the road and their amps weren't loud enough because their career was blowing up. So the bass player started building his own amps in his garage. And the amps became popular with other musicians and then eventually guitar players. And these were very, very cool tube amps. And eventually they moved to an industrial space. But I guess making amps and servicing them and marketing them and selling them was too hard for these guys. So eventually they sold it to a bigwig. And at that point, there were some pretty heavy artists with Sun amps appearing on stage, Jimi Hendrix, other people. But what happened is this bigwig bought Sun amplifiers, and for cost cutting, he turned them into solid state amps. So you see, the early Suns are big, you know, tall tube amps, right, that sound amazing. And then just a few years later, they're these kind of wafer-thin Coliseum lead amps that are solid state. And I remember, I thought they were cool when I was a little kid, but I didn't know at that point the difference between tubes and solid state. I was just seeing cool stacks when I saw a Sun Coliseum lead. It's just a really interesting story to me. But this sound, and a lot of you guys know this, this sound is from a Sun PA head with KT88 tubes. So for this, I'm using my 1967 Marshall PA head, and it sounds really good for this. Not quite as distorted, not quite as mid-rangey, but it works. Also, I borrowed a guitar for this. I don't have a Les Paul Junior. I actually am buying one, but it's not going to be here for about a month. A friend of mine is driving it down from Northern California. So I borrowed this from Angel City. It's a Shabat. It's called a Lion STP. It has a one P90 Lawler in it. And I really wanted a one pickup P90 guitar for this song. There's several reasons for that. Now, when you start to research the benefits, the virtues of a one pickup guitar, there's some good stuff out there. And Phil X actually has a very good couple of minutes when he talks about this. He believes that the magnetic pull from the pickup at the neck position actually restricts the strings a little bit. It makes them move a little less. And that could be true, because when I hit this guitar, this sustain is kind of uninterrupted and endless. The other thing I like about a P90 at the bridge is that often humbuckers at the bridge, it seems like the pole pieces are so close to the bridge that it gets a little nasally. Well, if you look at a P90, it's this way. So it has that edge, but it's also got a little more body because the pole pieces, it seems like the pickup is, you know, not as close to the bridge, the pole pieces. So I believe that too. So it might be anecdotal, it might be hearsay, but a one pickup guitar seems to sustain better, partly because of the magnetic pull from the second pickup, that's gone, and partly because you have solid wood all through this area. Oh, reminder, there's a sale on the Masterclass just this weekend. We have a 14-day free trial. There's a brand new beginner's course. I think I just added 18 videos to that a couple of days ago. Check it out if you want it. It's just this weekend. So anyway, I'm going to play a little more, but there's more to this story. It's so good and so heavy. Now on the rhythm part on this, the key for me, this slide has to be long, right? To make it sound like you've got to do that. Right? And you got to pull this up. Okay, let's try some of the riffs. Okay, let's check out the lead. That's one of my favorites. So Leslie played very simply, and he was kind of a minimalist in his approach, and the one pickup guitar was very important to him. I think the quote was, "You only need one match for a room full of gasoline." I thought that was pretty cool. And then his approach to soloing, he once told Joe Bonamassa that he needed to cut his output, his lead, you know, his riff output in half and then in half again, and then he'd have it right. So this is really good call and response playing. You know, the vocal happens and then he plays, you know, a riff right afterwards. This song, and I didn't know this, was kind of an unlikely hit. And what's really interesting to me is that it became a hit even though radio would only play it between midnight and 6 a.m. So I found out from an interview with him that during the day, Santana was blowing up, and they would play Santana songs because they were a little less heavy. This song was so heavy, they wouldn't play it during the day, only midnight to 6 a.m. And even with only being played those hours, it became a huge hit. And I thought that was really interesting. The other thing that's amazing that I found out about this, because there were no light gauge strings, Leslie actually took a set of strings and displaced it. And what that means, he put the E string on the B, and he put the B string on the G, and the G string on the D, and the D string on the A, and the A string on the E. The low E was gone, so the gauge got really light. And then for the missing high E string, he would take a banjo string, a 10, and put it on there. So he created his own set of light strings. Pretty great idea. Anyway, I'm gonna play along a little bit more, and then we'll talk a little bit. Perfect environment to do call and response. Trying to keep it simple. We can play fast. But I would like not too many fast riffs, I think is the way to go. So it's really fun to play kind of slow. And you can really blur the lines between minor and major pentatonic. I mean, he does it all the time, even in the rhythm part. The other crazy thing about this is that they VSO'd this record way up, and they used to do that a lot. They would finish the record and go, wow, this would be cool if it was a little faster, so they would crank up, you know, the multitrack, the tape machine, and make it a little faster so it would be more likely to be a hit. And this is, but it raises the pitch. This is like at 452. I had to crank my tuner up. No, it's even more. It's like 455. You know, not A440. It's like 15 cents sharp. So that's another thing. If you play along with this, be forewarned. You got to tune your guitar really sharp. I'm going to play a little more, and then we'll have a Q&A. Oh, one more reminder. Sale on the Masterclass this weekend. It's a 14-day free trial. 1,700 videos, 140 hours of content, and there's a new beginner's course. So check it out if you're interested in lessons. Let's play a little more, and then we'll do questions. Certainly milking notes is very effective. It's funny, the simpler I play, the better it works for this thing, I think. I mean, I'm tempted to go, you know. But it seems to sound better to go. Like very simple lines that actually leave a lot of spaces too. Big bends too. So pretty fun, pretty inspiring. I always loved this song, and I even love it more now. Yeah, Billy Gibbons tends to get all the cred for super light strings. And it's, I didn't know this. I mean, it's pretty cool what he did. It must have been so light and so easy to play. Really, really cool. Yeah, Tele Style with a P90. This is going to go, but I'm going to take this back today to Angel City. It's on their website. It's available if you, it's a really cool guitar. And I never do guitar endorsements. I never take fees for, you know, I think you guys know that. It's just, this is a Gibson scale. Thank you for that question. It's not a Fender scale. Yeah, playing slow. Works so great on this. Guitar Lord, no, I have never played here in Greece, but thank you for joining us from Greece. I would love to go to Greece. I love Europe. Going in September. Yeah, love it. Yeah, Suzanne, it makes a statement like a conversation. Music should be a conversation, and there's a lot of guitar playing out there that's just wall to wall, and I'm as guilty of that as anybody. But you know, a lot of the people I love from when I was growing up really knew that instinctively. They always, there was always space between phrases. Everybody, Hendrix, Clapton, Gibbons, there was always space. It's a hard thing to remember when you, you know, it just feels so good to play constantly. So. Yeah, Dan G, this is a great song for playing between major and minor because it's legal, either one. Or you find any song that has riffs down in this range. You're getting away from that range and you're up here and you can really bend the rules and play major or minor because the tonality is so undefined because everything is happening down here. Leslie said that he put down the vocals first and then filled the riffs. Otherwise, he would have played constantly with no room for the vocal. He said that the actual solo, I think, was kind of one take, but the fills around the vocals, he would sit there, they would record one, he would listen back and then evaluate what to do next. Which is what, you know, we all do in the studio if you can. But that's another benefit of call and response. So, you know what, I'm going to play a little more and then take a few more questions. It's just too fun to play on this. And so I'm gonna try and go simple. I'm gonna do one fast riff. How about that? Simple with one fast riff. That you don't sound like Leslie West anymore when you do that. Even there, when you start to play constantly, if you want to stay in his zone, got to be more like a vocalist. No vocalist would ever play that many notes. At least I don't think so. Oh, that's really cool too. Really heavy vibrato too. Yeah, absolutely. So the rig today is this P90 Shabat guitar. One thing about this is I like this headstock. I like it aesthetically. It's also got a straight string pull. Now, a Fender headstock does too. The straight string pull on any guitar is going to help you keep it in tune. That's why Fenders are so easy to keep in tune. That's why Gibsons can be problematic, because that G string, when it goes like this, it's that turn is just so annoying sometimes. You can set it up to where it works well, but a straight string pull is always going to stay in tune better. So I really like this headstock, and kudos to them for keeping a straight string pull. So the rig. This is a 1967 Marshall PA head that I got from Paul Reed Smith. He had traded it back and forth with Eric Johnson, I guess. Really lucky to have it. It sounds amazing. Below it is a plexi also. They both sound almost the same, but this PA head has something to it, maybe because they tweaked the tubes. These guys, they were trying to make it sound great or whatever. So this is going through a 412, jet engine loud in the vault in my garage. It's going through a 412 with vintage speakers. One of the speakers is from 1971, and one of the speakers is from 1978. Okay, that's it. So it's not actually as distorted as Leslie's sound, but for me today, I really worked a couple of hours to try and find the right sound, and the sounds that were too distorted didn't seem right. This one, you know, it's just where I'm at these days. I like a little more clarity in my distorted tone. So, but you can hear his tone has a little more mid-range and it's a little more distorted, but it kind of doesn't matter, right? I mean, you get the tone you like as long as it speaks. I mean, let me step on another pedal. So you can sort of hear it. Now I'll step on the Shanks pedal. Not bad. So here's the amp. Shanks ODS-1 added. Not bad. But you hear just a little, there's a little extra grunge on the sustain, right? And that's what I was trying to avoid by keeping it not too distorted. Deja Voodoo, I haven't read about him using any overdrive boost pedals. You've got to remember back then, there wasn't a lot of stuff available. And it was a virtue in some ways, because you really had to be inventive, but There weren't a lot of pedals available back then. Yeah, so there, I did do some fast playing. I mean, it's like, at a certain point, well, really, when as you play guitar, as you learn to play guitar, as you grow, you don't want to sound like your heroes. You want to incorporate what they do and sound like yourself. So definitely, for a little while, I try and emulate Leslie West, but what I really, really try and do is, and then just move on and have fun playing along with the track in my own style. And I recommend that for you guys. It's a vocabulary, and you wanna grow your vocabulary. Somebody asked a few seconds ago how I think of stuff so fast. It's just years and years of adding to the vocabulary, and you're just recombining stuff. That's the way the brain works and the heart works. You're recombining things in an instinctive way, and you're not even really thinking about it. So the more you do it, the better you'll get at this. And there are licks that are slightly different, that maybe are similar, part of the vocabulary, little connecting licks that are part of the vocabulary. So all of these guys, Hendrix, Clapton, Gibbons, B.B. King, all your heroes, Leslie West, keep learning their licks, and then it becomes yours, and your style becomes an amalgam of all of these bits that you've learned. And that's what makes it so fun. And it'll come fast for you the more you do it. See if you can get that guitar in your hands a couple of hours a day. It'll get better. So, guys, we're at our limit right now. I want to thank you so much for joining. This was a really an amazing thing. I didn't realize there was such a story behind all of this. And your questions have been great. Have a great Saturday. I'm going to play us out. And I'll see you guys next time. Thanks so much.